Welcome back, everyone. S1E1, we are here again every episode to remind you we watch the very first episode of a different sitcom. We discuss it as if we've never seen any other episodes, and then at the end, we go around and we discuss if that's a show that we would greenlight or cancel, again, based on only the first episode. So this week, we will be doing Community, which was 6 seasons long. It was on NBC, but the last season I think was on Yahoo. 110 yep. Episodes. First episode called Pilot, just like half the other shows we're going to be tackling on the show.
No, the first episode is called Community.
Well, it was called Pilot when I looked it up. According to IMDb, it said Pilot, but it's called either Pilot or Community, apparently, unless we watch different episodes, which will be a big, big problem later in the episode if we did.
It'll happen someday.
September 17th, 2009 is when it aired. My name's Jay Gags. With me, as always this week, Joe, Ferg, Nick, and Gordo. What's up, guys?
Hey-o.
Hey.
Boy, I love Chevy Chase so much.
Oh, yeah.
To start things off for this episode, which was called either Community or Pilot, as I think Ferg's checking right now, anyone seen Community before? Has anyone not seen Community, I should say?
Me.
No episodes at all.
Never. I got it mixed up with Parks and Rec, which I also haven't seen. And I thought that's what we were going to watch.
Oh, wow.
That's what I had going into it.
Can we just take a break here? Has Gordo seen any show we've done?
Yes. I've seen some. I saw
every show starts with you saying, no, I haven't seen it.
No. Not true. The first episode, I said I saw it. It was just on in the background, Friends, Dinosaurs I'd seen, Home Improvement I'd seen. I've never even heard of Perfect Strangers.
What? You'd never heard of Perfect Strangers?
No.
To be fair, that is when his TV
fell on. No, because I'm not like 80. Why would I watch that? I didn't like it when you made me watch it.
We all watched it. That's why I'm asking, because we all watched it. And we're all the same age and we all watched
it. No, you didn't. Nobody watched that show.
Gordo, every time I was at your house when we were kids, Nick at Night was on. So don't say because it's old you didn't watch it. You watched a lot of old shit.
Nick at Night. That was like,
I'm just
that was
saying
like
in general.
Lucy, that was like The Munsters. That was like not Andy Dick, the Andy Mulberry show.
You know what I'm talking about.
and I've seen News Radio. I've never seen Community. You will find that there are a lot of these shows that I haven't seen.
Gordo was just too busy playing that video game. What was the video game he got mad at us for trying to get him out of the house?
It was like Animaniacs or something like that.
Not fucking going anywhere.
Okay. All right. Well, okay.
We're on a tangent here.
So,
I haven't seen it.
You guys have all seen Community?
Yes.
Okay.
It's actually one of my favorite shows.
So I have to tell on me. And say that, like Gordo, I haven't watched Community. I'm familiar with the show to a certain degree. I've seen a couple minutes here and there, but not enough to the point where I've never seen a full episode. I couldn't tell the name of any characters. So I went into this pretty fresh myself. Just to follow up, because Ferg just showed us his screen and he looked up something that said that the first episode was called Community, and that was on what?
That's on Netflix. It's listed. The first episode is listed as Community.
Okay, so on Netflix, it's listed as Community. On IMDb, it's listed as Pilot.
It can still be a pilot and be called something else.
Well, no,
I'm sure we watched the same episode though, right? Because
I'm sure we did. But typically, in an episode guide, like when
the spaceship comes down,
whether it's a pilot,
the part where Poochie came out,
the pilot is usually listed as the title of the show unless it's called Pilot. Which for me, that's what it's showing. But either way, either it's called Pilot or Community, depending on what you are searching on. Hopefully, we're all talking about the same episode.
I still think Pilot should be the only episode of Wings.
But
every episode.
Okay, so the show starts off outside of a campus, and we see that someone is going to speak or address people using a like old boombox, and he has like a little flub, and it starts playing some sort of hip-hop song with inappropriate lyrics. I don't think it was a real song. It was nothing that I recognized.
No,
I believe it was written for the show,
Never mind. I was going to say it's a reoccurring joke throughout the series, but the series doesn't exist.
Yeah. We only discuss episode one. It was like a fun joke to start on. I mean,
I
love how the PA is just this old shitty boom. Yeah. They couldn't even get like an amp to talk through.
So, and then it turns out that he's the dean of the school, And it's like, shouldn't you have access to, you know, some sort of a speaker system or like, but.
I like that, though. It sets the mood of how shitty of a school it is. It also reminded me a lot of the beginning of Rock and Roll High School, which I loved.
And they also use this moment for him to, he's kind of having, he's introducing people to the school, essentially. You know, he's using a whether you're this or you're that. And this is the way that they are basically exposing you to half the cast of the show, because he's explaining the character type of
the entire cast of the show.
So I haven't written if nobody has it down.
That, I have it on my phone too, but that speech is like, that's community college. If anyone's ever gone, like in a nutshell, there is,
but like, I went for like 10 minutes
and everything. It's like,
yeah, I didn't go to community college, and that's not throwing any shade. I didn't go to any college, so I'm not not making fun of anybody. If you went to community college, that's amazing. You're doing better than me. But
I went long enough to have a student ID. That was so I can pretend I went to college because I have an ID.
Well, I attended North Shore Community College right before I went to UMass. But yeah, it was literally that's that speech. Every single one of those people was in like my opening, like what's it called? Yeah, opening class thing. That there was an old person, there was a former athlete that got hurt. There was everything. It was crazy.
Yeah, it was
so
very.
What do they say? They say remedial teens, 20-something dropouts, middle-aged divorcees, and old people keeping their minds active as they circle the drain of eternity.
Yes, fucking great line. Chevy Chase is just his physical comedy. Like it's still there too. Like the face he makes.
And this show was everything edited out but Chevy Chase for the whole time, and it was a 7-minute episode. It would be my favorite TV show in the history of TV shows.
I didn't actually know Chevy Chase was a part of this show. Like, I had no idea about this show going in, and I was floored by the cast. Like,
so I want to get into some of the specifics with some of the cast later.
Okay.
But I will say, no, but, you know, for now, you know, just to go to where we're talking about Chevy Chase, as big as Chevy Chase is in like, you know, he has had like so many legendary roles in huge movies. When you look at the list of things he's done, he had a lot of really big accomplishments. Leading up into this show, he really hasn't done a lot of stuff.
You know why, right?
He hasn't done anything since.
You know why?
Why would that be?
Because he is a grade A asshole.
I've heard
nobody can work with him.
I want to. I'm just gonna say I love Chevy Chase so much that until he's an asshole to me, I think.
And that's
wrong.
The thing that it sticks in my head because I love his character so, and I love everything he does so much. I've literally never heard a good behind the scenes thing about that guy. Like he's just a ripe dick about everything. Apparently,
anybody who's worked with him on the vacation movies, not one bad thing to say. I don't know what
really
that means, but yeah, like Beverly D'Angelo, Johnny Galecki, anybody who's like worked.
He's apparently a nightmare to the staff, but other actors have enjoyed working with him. Like I know Donald Glover, who plays Troy on the show. Yep. He says like he pushed him to be better. And
he's
stuff
also
like that.
Probably
like,
at a very different point of his life now, right? So like you got to figure, you know, if what Nick's saying is all true, and I've heard similar things, but again, we're talking, he had a big monstrous run in like the late 70s, early 80s, had a bunch of huge hits, and then went like 30 years where he wasn't really doing much of anything. So you know, for a mix of, he had roles, right? He hasn't been out of work completely. He's had little roles here and there, but like
the 90s,
not a lot of major stuff.
Yeah, the 90s and 2000s are weird, right? He does Memoirs of Invisible Man, which bombs.
He's in
it's
Dirty
kind of
work.
A weird movie. And then he does the Chevy Chase show. Do you guys remember the Chevy Chase show on Fox?
Yep. That train wreck.
Yeah, it was like just a bad train wreck sort of. But people make fun of that and look back at it as really bad. But followed up by that was Keenan Ivory Wayans did the same show. And his was equally as bad. I watched every episode of both. It wasn't like his was that much worse than anybody else's. But he didn't really do too much. I mean, he pops back up in the Vacation remake with Ed
Why
Holmes.
Did you watch the Keenan Ivory Wayans show?
Because there was nothing else to watch at 1 a.m. at that point, unless WAAF's Real Rock TV was on. There wasn't much else for us to watch.
I don't know. You could
then.
Always sleep.
That didn't seem fun at the time. Pharmaceutically, I didn't like sleeping back then.
We'll circle back to him later because you don't really see him again until kind of midway through the episode. So because after the speech is delivered, we're introduced to a couple guys. It's Jeff and Abed. Is that how you say it?
Abed. Troy and Abed in the morning.
Okay. Again, I'm pretty new to the show. So this is actually the first time we're doing an episode where I really don't know what we're talking about. So bear with me. But so we meet them. They're walking down. Abed is very like fast talking. talking a little off, but you know, seems intelligent. You can't quite pinpoint what it is about him, but he's a little off. Jeff looks to be the main character from what you're seeing early in the show. Takes an eye to a blonde girl really early, so really kind of establishing like this is going to be his story arc. He's looking for this girl, and gets a little bit of information from Abed. Jeff is so we find out Jeff's story. Jeff is a lawyer, but he faked his degree, so now he has to go to community college to get an actual degree. I don't know how that works. So he faked his degree, but and then could just take the bar with like a fake degree. I don't know how this works. I'm not a lawyer myself, but sure.
It's yeah, I don't know that out there. People don't know. You know, we don't. Nobody holds you to it, Jay.
Early impressions of these characters, by the way, as you meet them.
I like that I get a little bit of Mighty Ducks from this. I don't know if anybody else did, but rewatching this now, he feels a bit like Gordon Bombay, right?
Redemption story.
Yeah, it's a lawyer redemption story, and he's surrounded by a bunch of sort of misfit kids, yeah. And then they're all, yeah. Not kids; they're all older ages. But like, it seems like that's the story.
I mean,
if Abed or if somebody else drove a limousine onto the ice, we'd be right there.
Again, I mean, early on, you get that Jeff is pretty sleazy. I mean, you can tell He doesn't want to talk to Abed. He just asks him the time, and then Abed goes into a long tangent.
Yeah. And he gets into the whole, like, I see your worth thing. Like, that's all people are to him is, like, what they're worth.
He just sees them for what he can do for him.
And right from there is when Jeff's character goes to meet with Dr. Duncan, who's played by John Oliver. So I was like, oh, shit, John Oliver.
Yep. I said the same thing. I was like, so Chevy was Chase and John Oliver? I was like, how did I not know about this show?
Yeah, so, and I know, like, John Oliver, like, now. Like, I know his, like, hosting duty, so like I didn't know much about like his acting career before this, so I was just like, oh, that's cool. But
was he on the Daily Show at this point?
Probably
no. Yeah, I think he
definitely
was, maybe at was that time
I think this was Daily Show time, yeah, because that's where like I would have known
sounds about right
at that
and
point. Yeah,
and Gordo, that's part of the reason I think you haven't heard of the show, because it's honestly it's a great show, but a lot of people are kind of in your boat, I think, as far as either not watching it or not really knowing about it. Excuse me, this kind of went up against some heavy hitting shows in their primes on different networks, so like yeah. if this show had come out, you know, 5 years earlier or later, it would have done way better, I think, because this show is better than 6 seasons that it got. I think it just, yeah, there was too much competition in the area at the time.
Could not go too far into past just talking about the pilot, but from my understanding of this show, from an outside perspective, it seems like a show that has a very, very loyal fan base, mm-hmm. and it gets a strong enough viewer, but it's always been kind of like on the brink of going away at all times. Like it never had like a strong run.
Yep.
So that's my, you know, what I've always seen of the show.
I also feel like at the time, like we'd watch it here and there, it'd be on TV, you'd sort of catch it or whatever, but my younger sister loved it, right? She had like mugs of the characters and things like that. So just the age group we are in, right? So somebody who was 6 years younger than us were obsessed with it.
Well, I think what helps the show was Netflix, because when I got into it, it was on Netflix and it was still on TV. But I think the first 3 seasons I watched on Netflix, and then I had the new season started and I had to wait each week to watch it, which sucks when you
get. So that was one of the first big shows to be on Netflix then.
Yeah.
When they first started streaming stuff as like a whole, right? But when they stopped the DVD thing.
And it seems weird because it's a show that, you know, having now seen the first episode and just generally knowing about the show, like its brand of humor is pretty lined up with like our group of friends, at least. And it's not really a show that we've ever really talked about much. It doesn't come up very often, once in a while for sure, because you know a handful of you guys watch it, but generally speaking, you know, for a bunch of guys who talk all the time and about TV, I don't think Community's really come up all that much.
Yeah, it was on a weird.
Well, watch it and we can talk about it, because like I said, it's one of my favorite shows.
Well, I've watched.
Well, we'll discuss whether or not it's gonna happen in about 40 minutes.
Yeah. So that interaction, to go back with the professor Duncan, basically we see that Jeff is, you know, he lied his way to get his degree in the first place, and now he's gonna see if there's a way that he can lie to get a new degree from this place. So that's
one of my favorite lines, when Duncan says to him, I thought you got your bachelor's from Columbia, and then he says, well, now I have to get one from America.
Also, if you guys are seeing a theme, what happened with John Oliver, what was his excuse? 9/11.
Okay.
So that's Friends. That's Perfect Strangers brings up 9/11.
When does Perfect Strangers bring up
9/11? It started in like 88. Like,
you brought up 9/11.
yes, Joe. This continues the trend of you bringing up 9/11 in every episode. What the fuck?
What is wrong with you?
By the way, we've we've established like our show is explicit in that like we are allowing ourselves to use foul language. I have made it a point to personally not, and I just had to in that moment because I'm like, what the hell is going on right now?
So are you saying that when discussing 9/11, you wanted to use plain language?
I want to discuss 9/11 on 9/11 only for the most part,
never forget.
Not necessarily when we're talking about sitcoms.
Well, if a sitcom brings it up, wait till
I never want to do Wings because of the 9/11 thing. All right,
we can't do Wings. I don't know if I can handle Wings.
We have to do Wings.
It'll be a special episode. Like
on 9/11
of just Joe, like a monologue, just Joe talking independently about the show for, you know, a half hour, what have you.
I think that the fans demand it. We'll have to do it. But Gordo, to your point, they do mention it. They actually do mention it in this episode. Do I find it everywhere? Every show we've done? Yes. But this one, they do mention it.
You're like one of those alien hunters that you go down to like Columbia or something. And you're like, oh, these rocks, they fit together so intricately. It's got to be aliens who did it. You know, like
Joe should star in the movie, The Number 23 or whatever it was called.
I just see what I see.
If I may take a moment to talk about the show again. So I have in my notes here, because after his interactions with Duncan, where we find out, so Duncan is a professor at the college who Jeff has, who acted as the lawyer for in the past. So he's hoping to leverage that to maybe get the answers to his tests while he's there so he can pass. The note I have written down is Jeff is a piece of shit.
He's supposed to be.
Yeah.
But it's great though. I'm like cutting off to like, have you seen this? But has anybody seen the movie where they do the National Lampoon's? Netflix did it, A Futile and Stupid Gesture, basically the history of National Lampoon.
No.
And Doug Kenny.
No.
I did see that.
No.
It's worth watching,
good.
Right?
But it's good.
But what's his name who plays Jeff in this? I can't think of the actor's name. Very funny guy. Anyway, but Jeff in this plays young Chevy Chase.
Yeah.
And when you go back and watch this,
Joel McHale.
Thank you. When you go back and watch this and you see the way he's acting, you definitely see him doing young Chevy Chase. And I think it's pretty fun. And when he's doing all these like sort of monologues to everybody and how he's being in the sarcasm and the sort of weird stuff, I feel like that's the first thing I get is he's being young Chevy. And then you see old Chevy.
Yeah, that's cool.
Okay.
So we go from he is talking to Duncan. He's trying to, you know, maneuver his way into cheating his way through community college to him meeting the girl Britta, who was the girl that he had eyes for earlier when he was walking. And he knows her from Spanish class and he sees her studying. So now he lies about his credentials in Spanish and said he's like an authorized like tutor or whatever. And he's going to have a study group for Spanish to basically, you know, find a reason to be around her. So again, Jeff is a giant piece of shit.
He's scheming.
And Britta says what's on her mind. Unlike her name, she's unfiltered.
Oh my god. So at this point, watching the show, as you're introduced to these guys up front, Jeff, so far, we know that he did shitty things that put him there. He's done shitty things trying to get out of there, and now he's doing shitty things to get with this girl. Is he showing any signs of being likable yet, or are you turned off to the character? Is he too shitty, or do you kind of still think, well, let's see where this is going at this point?
I'm intrigued at this point still.
He's just so charismatic, kind of, which is like true to the character that I want to think they want. And that's how he basically faked being a lawyer for so long.
Yep.
He's charismatic. He knows how to talk. He's confident. And by that alone, like I am intrigued by him.
It's like how he says it. If he talks long enough, he can make anything truthful or moral, something like that. And he says it either doesn't matter or I'm God.
I love that. That's my favorite line of the whole episode. Yeah. So what's the exact line? I have it written down because I thought it was so funny. So either I'm God or truth is relevant.
Yeah, that's
which is like, what a great way to live your life. If you're going to be a scumbag, that's the motto, right?
I guess I'm the opposing view right now. At this point of the episode, I don't like him. I'm like, he's just too shitty. This is like, there's not enough there yet. But I can see like where he's charismatic enough that let's give it time. I did think they were stacking on a lot of bad behavior all at once, but it is still pretty early in the episode. So
yeah, they're establishing his character though. So you can get that redemption throughout, you know, the series, but we're in one episode. So
this is also where you meet Chevy Chase and he spends a minute making a hot dog in the funniest way any human being has ever made a hot dog. Where I rewound it and watched it twice. I was laughing so hard. It's just so
fucking perfect.
Why was there mayonnaise in the ketchup?
Yeah.
Well, because it's a community card.
When he's done, he just shoves it under the tray of bread slices. It's so good. And they just walk away and just let you sort of sit in it. It's so great.
I like how the other student watches him do it and he just kind of is like, you know, he kind of like eyes like, no, you didn't see anything.
Nobody could do that. Like he could too. Like
it's just talent. That
physical.
It's the most Clark Griswold thing ever.
Yeah, it's so good.
So we get to the actual study group, which is just the two of them at first. So this is kind of where they're starting to communicate more past their little interaction that they had in the cafeteria. And we kind of learn her past a little bit. It's pretty clear, like, again, that this is going to be the love interest story. She talks about how she left high school to impress Radiohead, or in her head, she thought it would impress Radiohead, which is like, I thought that was a weird line. All right. It's like, it was her leaving school going to result in like an article that went viral or something where Radiohead was going to be like, wow, this is really cool how this girl left school.
We've already expressed at this point, she's kind of dumb, right? Like she didn't understand that Jeff was not speaking the right kind of Spanish. And
we established that she's not good at Spanish though. Like she's, she doesn't speak Spanish. So like, that's the whole reason she's there.
Jeff barely does either.
Yeah.
But she doesn't know that. She's just trusting
his life. He speaks like Peggy Hill Spanish.
Yeah.
No, not even that. He's just saying.
He just makes
noise. He knows. Like he talks about the car when he's answering her question. I forget what she asked, but
Randy calls himself El Jefe, which is the chief, not Jeff,
the boss. Yeah,
the Jeff.
He's just speaking with conviction. So, like you know, fake it till you make it. He's acting confident, and as a result, she believes that you know she doesn't know Spanish. So why wouldn't she think that he was speaking fluently?
One little joke too, when she's talking about her past, and she's like, "Oh, I've been tear gassed here. I dropped out of high school. I did some foot modeling." Is a great like you know what the foot modeling thing means, right? Yeah. She wasn't foot modeling.
A little bit of a free spirit, wandering soul. But she does make it very clear to him that the number one most important thing to her is honesty. And she's telling this to someone who we know is the most dishonest person.
Hasn't been honest yet. Yeah.
Yeah. He's been honest about zero things since he's walked into this campus.
The only thing he's been honest about is trying to get the test answers from John Oliver.
Yeah. So this turns into actually what I thought was one of the funniest parts of this episode was so she texts Abed to join the study group and he's trying to sidebar with him. So he sends him a text to say, "Me, like, I've talked to you outside."
Yeah.
And he's like, never received a text message before. He's like, "Oh, I've never gotten a text before." And he's trying to read it.
Do you have to pee? No.
Why would I have to pee?
So I like how he physically shows her the phone too.
Yes.
Yeah. So I was thinking though, like I've never received a text before. And I was trying to think like, all right, this is 2009. I probably started texting in around 2004, like our senior year. It's probably when I started actually text messaging.
Yeah.
So I'm like, I mean, he's not the most social butterfly. Like, I don't think we're led to believe that he has a lot of friends, but like, I did think like he's never received a text before. Like this joke probably would have checked out maybe 3 years earlier and been a little bit more believable. But
no, I think it's just like
he has no friends.
Home his character.
But even like his mom doesn't text him or something. Like, I don't know. Whatever. I thought I got a laugh out of it.
That comes up a little later, I think.
Yep. He mentions Britta and she calls him or somebody says something about a disease her brother has. He should look up, which is a pretty funny joke.
Yeah. That was right in that that first scene where they were walking.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then Jeff gets a text and it goes back to Albert. Does it say you have to pee? Yeah.
Yeah. And then he gets the text from John Oliver, which is like supposed to be in code or something. I forget what it was.
What was John Oliver's text say? It's all a mix of letters and numbers.
I remember like pausing it and I'm like trying to decipher it myself. I'm like, I have no idea what this means. I wish I wrote it down, but I did not.
I do like that too, though. They show the text. They show the translation being wrong in Spanish. I always love when they sort of bring you into those things where you feel like you're more in the world.
Yep.
Yeah.
You get like an idea of what's actually happening. It breaks you down from being into a TV show and sort of
it gives you the visual and you don't have to guess the joke, you know what I mean? Like they show you the text and you can see how absurd it is, because that's going to be a tough one to just read out loud and fully get what they're trying to convey, right? So showing you the actual text message makes it very clear how absurd his coding is.
Quick question though, with the text messages, were those, are we in the era of smartphone, right? We're not in the era of flip phone still using numbers, right?
2009 is,
it's like on the line, honestly.
It's on the line, because that's kind of what
smartphones completely yet, not in 2009,
because that's what I got with like the John Oliver text. Well, was
Jeff,
like
he Jeff was has trying a black to, Jeff has a BlackBerry at the time.
Yeah, I think we may have had the first iPhone phone, but people had BlackBerries, or just I think that's right when phones started having this thing
around with smartphones.
You could like text on them,
which is kind of funny to think about, because you know, of the shows that we've done, you know, within our show so far, Community is by far the newest show, and to even think by their pilot, like smartphones weren't completely there yet, you know, in 2009. Yeah. It's a little funny to look back at. It reminds me of like when we were younger, right? So right around that same time, maybe a year or two earlier, is like, remember we would text Joe because he would get mad because they were like 10 cents each.
Yeah.
That's just no joke, man. People talk about that now. Like kids won't remember how insane that was, but that added up.
Yeah. So for younger listeners, you know, once upon a time before you had unlimited texting, every text cost about 10 cents each, which didn't matter because you didn't text that much and your phone can only hold about 30 text messages at a time.
And your parents paid the bill.
Paid for it.
Yeah. But yeah, but panel member Joe was very, very upset because we would text him like just like a single
I was
letter.
Getting in trouble. I was getting yelled at.
That 10 cents was adding up pretty quick.
R-U-C-O-M. Yeah, those were not fun.
Dude, we did mean things like that to Joe, and you hate Jeff so much. Come on, Jay.
So, and also to go back to the show, when Jeff runs out, Britta does show a little bit of sign, like she asks Abed, like, do you think this dude's okay? Like, so I guess she's questioning his character a little bit at this point. Like something seems a little off to her because she did note, is he okay to you? Like,
well, I have a question for you guys. I didn't look this up purposely because I thought it'd be funnier to ask you. Who is Elizabeth Shue?
Elizabeth Shue is Allie from Karate Kid.
Oh,
she okay. also doesn't look like her.
I knew the name, right? And that makes more sense. It's way more in my wheelhouse, Karate Kid's like 84.
So I looked that up.
I was like, why do I know this name? But I didn't want to ruin the podcast fun of me not looking up who it was.
Right. So I was going to bring it up later because it comes up twice, right? Abed says something to her and out of nowhere when he brings it up, he just looks at her and just goes, you look like Elizabeth Shue. And then way later on, Jeff says the same thing to her. And it's kind of it's like a running joke where they both said it in completely different times.
I also don't see it.
Yeah, I don't.
I don't see it at all.
I don't necessarily.
Yeah, now that I remember who she is, I don't see it.
Yeah, it was just a weird joke, but they went back to it twice. So I don't know. I thought maybe there was a link. I even tried looking up, like maybe that's her mother or something. That was a joke. But from what I understand, unless it's something that we don't know, like a very specific link, then I have no idea where that joke came from. But when Jeff comes back to the study group after talking to Duncan, we are now introduced to a full group. Now, word got out of the study group, so now we've entered four more people have joined the study group. So now we're at what, a total of seven of six. Them when you count
oh, yeah.
Jeff?
Yeah.
Yep.
So going back, as we talked about this a little bit with Chevy Chase, I was like, oh my God, look at this cast. Like, this is a great cast. But when you think in the context of 2009, this is just great casting because
they weren't anything yet. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, like, everyone has done stuff. Like, Donald Glover, you know, now Childish Gambino.
Chevy Chase
Childish
is the only
Gambino.
One.
He's done so much stuff. And at that point, he was doing a lot of online comedy skits. And he was a writer for 30 Rock leading into Community. Like, he had to leave 30 Rock to be in Community. So, like, he was, like, starting his foot in. But, like, you wouldn't know him, really, unless you, like, watched Bro Rape on...
I was going to say the Derek Comedy Group, though, which we all watched all those videos. Stuff. And that was him. That was...
Moynihan,
Ellie Kemper.
Moynihan? Yeah, Ellie Kemper, Bobby Moynihan.
Yeah. Bobby Moynihan, who's one of the funniest people ever.
Yeah, so like a lot of people came out, but like, you know, if, you know, that
Why
was
are the
a,
police outside?
Yeah.
So, like, cool.
We
all right.
Watching that stuff, but that stuff was like, you know, not wildly known by everybody. So like Donald Glover, Chevy Chase, we already talked about. We have Yvette Nicole Brown, who plays Shirley in the show. I looked up her IMDb. She was on a ton of stuff, but like nothing super, super notable.
She was on The Office real quick.
The Office
That's
is
the
only
thing
I
recognize
her.
Right yeah. away. Yeah. yeah.
She worked at Staples with Dwight in an episode of The
yeah,
Office.
Yeah. I don't care about him, his big eyes or yeah. big head or his beady eyes. Yeah,
oh,
that's
I don't
her
like
line when they work at Staples together.
And then,
as an ex Staples employee, I really take that to heart.
That's right. And to round out the group, Allison Brie, who like I know from Glow, and I know she's done a bunch of stuff, but like even at that point, I looked it up, she hadn't done a ton at that point. So like really, the, you know, props to the casting director, because they got a bunch of diamond in the roughs. Like,
yeah,
They hit on everybody for the most part.
Not to get into the future, but that also leads to the show's downfall because they all get so big, they all start leaving one by one. And that's what makes the show go downhill.
But we don't know that yet because we're watching episode one.
Saying in general. I'm not saying that as like the first episode in general. I'm just saying that that's a bad thing. That's what leads to the show dying.
Also, to back-to-back shows bring up Wayne's World. When I saw Allison Brie, I got that Dreamweaver like thing Wayne gets when he sees Cassandra the second she popped up. I'm so in love with Allison Brie. But the second she was on the screen, I just like everything stopped for a moment and I had to like pause.
She is very attractive. And it's weird too, like the contrast between her and Britta. And Britta is like supposed to be the attractive one. You know what I mean? And Allison Brie is just like 100 yards ahead of her. And so it's weird to just have her be like the geeky weird one.
Well, I guess it's, I mean, this all goes to like my personal preference is Allison Brie, but it's all subjective, right? And they're both, you know, very attractive.
Yeah, they're both good looking, but.
And it's like in the same way with like, you know, a lot of things. Usually it's a lot of shows do this really. It's like the blonde one gets to be the pretty one. And then the pretty brunette is not considered to be the pretty one for whatever reason. Mm. But that's just that's
but I will say Glow is where she came to her own, right? Like that's the best thing she's done.
Yeah, I mean, big star.
Grand scheme, she really hasn't done much.
Yeah, there's a few movies recently she's done, I think. But Glow, I think, elevated her to a sort of next level.
For sure. I feel like she was supposed to play like She-Hulk, and that didn't end up panning out. But
she's so tiny.
Well, I'm glad she didn't, because know, who cares about any of these modern superhero movies? They're all the worst.
What?
You're the worst.
No, they're all the worst. You're all watching movies that have 20 movies that make you watch them before you watch them and after you watch them. They're just taking your money. It's the worst.
You know there's like considerable amounts of planes crashing into buildings in these movies, right?
Let's talk after this episode.
Don't be so jaded, Joe.
I do not want this to be a running joke every episode. It's going to be really awkward for people. But
it's a running joke in our friendship. It's going to be a running joke in the show.
Anyways, Jeff sees this whole group and he's like, I'm out of here. I'm not doing this. And Britta catches up with him. Now it's all of a sudden like Britta, it will go out with him. Like now it's like, you know, if we make this group work, I'll go out with you. It's just the dynamic of their relationship. Like every scene was very weird to me. I don't feel like they established it enough.
By the way, at this point, we have figured out that Jeff got the wrong answers too.
No,
that's after.
No, that's after. Because that's after John Oliver has to call him.
That's right.
Yeah, going to the football field, and also that's when you meet the other people too. But like you understand what's happening. You find out that Chevy Chase is a moist towelette magnet.
Pierce Hawthorne.
The handshake thing killed me.
And we'll get to that in a few minutes.
But Britta at that point has figured him out. That's why she agrees to date him. She manipulates him.
Right. I just thought that. No, I don't know how the show pans out, and I'm going in fresh, which is good because we're only talking about this episode. I don't feel like these two, although both decent actors, I don't think they have a lot of chemistry. Something seems off about them to me as I watched them. And I just felt like there wasn't enough build up to understand, like, we get that he likes her, but her response to everything was so like, she just like gets that he likes all of a sudden and is just like, I don't know why we're really here. I'll go out with you if we make this work. I don't know. I just felt like it was really abrupt. I don't know.
It almost seems boredom, right? Like she's bored. She's like, oh, this guy is fun to mess with for a little bit. If we'll go on a date with him, it doesn't matter. We'll just deal with this for now.
I just thought it was a weird dynamic.
But I don't think you're supposed to feel a connection between them. They're very different. He just wants to bang her.
Yeah.
And she's like an activist. He's a lawyer. So he is basically what she hates, you know? So you shouldn't feel a connection there.
But I think she's a phony activist the same way he's a phony good person, right? Like I think there's actually more in common by the fact that she doesn't really know where she is and she's lied about stuff and he doesn't know where he is and he's lied about stuff and now they're sort of crashed together.
I didn't pick that up though. That she wasn't what she said she was. You know, they're kind of on the same playing field where they're both playing each other. I didn't pick that up yet.
Where do you get that she isn't what she says she was? I think she's pretty honest.
Because she talks about she was, I did this. I was a foot model. I was an activist. I was here. I was there. I dropped out of high school. I was tear gassed. Like she's had like all these different lives and now she's trying to put it back together. So I don't feel like any of those were 100% genuine.
I don't know. Again, for me, it's just like, it really just goes to, I don't feel like these two have chemistry. Now, could I be wildly wrong?
I don't think that's the play. I don't think that's what they're trying to do, though. That it's pretty obvious that she's not into him.
In any event, her just saying, basically, hey, if you can make the study group work, I'll go out with you, was enough for him. So now he's all in. So he heads right back in, and now we're going to try to make this work. You know, the group, now you're kind of introduced to the group a little bit more. You see, and like, they're very dysfunctional, all different people. I loved Pierce's creepy advances on Shirley.
The harassment wasn't line.
Like, amazing.
It wasn't just like, oh, he likes her and he's like being cute about it. Like, he's saying just weird shit to
her.
I love that she's the only one he actually learned the correct name for when he's introducing them all.
Yep. And that's how you first, that's like the, when you go, oh, he likes her, because that's the only one he knows. And like, they were like, no, we're not being subtle. Like, by the next time he speaks, he said something, can't remember exactly what he said to her right now, but it was something really weird.
Yeah, because everyone has a nickname at this point. It's like Little Annie Adderall.
Yeah.
Everyone's got like a little nickname.
Abed the Arab.
Yeah, Shirley's the only one he gives the actual name to. And then we find out also that Donald Glover was the prom king. So as a prom king, I didn't know if you guys want to do
truth,
like a...
By the way, so for those of you watching
up against
along,
Katie Caligiuris, wasn't it?
the one
she hated that.
The one in it wasn't her, but I don't want to get into isolating the audience too much. The prom queen was Marissa Rivera, I believe.
That's correct.
In any event, for those of you who don't actually know us personally, if you were to look at our cartoon image that we use as a logo, the man in the Devo hat,
Energy Dome,
the Energy Dome wearing caricature, that is Joe right there. And he was, in fact, prom king.
How did that happen?
It was randomly selected.
Yeah, just the universe gave me one.
That was Joe's participation trophy for high school.
They're like, well, he's not going to do anything better than this, so we might as well throw him a bone.
They're like, we need to put something under his name in the yearbook, and we have nothing.
Well, I think that it worked out just great for all of us.
I have a podcast now, damn it.
Troy was a quarterback and the prom king, but he lost his scholarship because of injury where he hurt himself on a keg.
Cake flip.
Cake flip, not a keg stand.
And then with Annie, we find out that she was addicted to Adderall and got kicked out of school. And they went to school together, apparently. So that's how we find out about both of them.
And is she crazy younger? Trying to say that she's like so young, she was in high school, like a Doogie Howser scenario.
I thought she was young compared to the fact that the group has a bunch of adults in it.
I thought that she was only young compared to like Shirley, who they were kind of having like,
but then she
forth.
Should be not that far from Donald Glover, and
they went to school together.
They discussed that, they sat behind each other.
But they keep saying she's young, so what I'm saying is, was she like
above grades? She was young.
And Pierce and Jeff, she's younger than all of them.
Everybody else.
But her and Glover are roughly the same age. She wasn't young. Okay.
That they're actually like conventionally college age if they were to go straight from high school, where most of them are not quite at that point. A few of them are older. And I'll say this, as much as I like Alison Brie, I felt like she overacts this role really hard. Like, she's playing a very specific caricature. Like, her,
I didn't get that vibe at all. I thought you did.
I think when I watched it back, because I watched the episode twice. So the second time I watched it, and I watched the episode once and I take notes, and then the second time I try to watch it and just enjoy the episode so I can like maybe pick up on things again. And when I did that, I was like, she's really aggressively playing the role. Like, there's not like subtleties to her character. She plays it very, very extreme, but in a way that like if she was in a play, it would translate. But I don't need to be that.
I'm with Jay on this one. I think that she's definitely putting her foot down on the role.
That's the role itself. Yep. She's an Adderall addict. So she's going to be like all hyped up, and you know, you don't know if she's at this point, you don't know if she's like just freshly cleaned. You don't know if she's still doing it. You don't know, but like she plays that kind of, and how do you get Adderall? I mean, unless, you know, you have some kind of it's a neurological drug. So it makes you neurotic.
No, I don't think she's doing Adderall because she's getting Adderall. I think she's finding Adderall outside of.
I think she might have a prescription. And
I was under the impression that she's like a student who like cares about her grades, but like pulls all nighters studying and
was
like
Jesse Spano.
Yeah. She was just on caffeine pills.
Those don't really do anything.
No. No.
Not when you take that many of them for so long.
So this, learning about Jeff and what's her name? What's her name on the show again?
Annie. Oh, Annie.
I said Jeff. After the Troy and Annie thing where they both kind of expose each other's past, we get into what I think was the best part of the whole episode, which is Abed doing the Breakfast Club monologue.
Oh, God, yes.
The smoke up Johnny stuff. It was so out of left field.
The whole John Bender monologue.
Yeah, I have that actually written down as the funniest line of the whole thing, just because it came so far out of nowhere.
I loved it. I love that he didn't even really deliver it as his character, which to me made it better. Like,
yes.
You know, he should have been doing it as himself, really. But it was like written in a way that like, just do the monologue. It doesn't matter. Like, just play it serious.
Just do it. He looked to Jeff for approval afterwards too, and he was like, what? I thought this is what we needed.
What I didn't understand was right after the Dirty Dancing reference.
Oh, yeah.
I know he's like a film guy, but he's...
I mean, I appreciate that. He's just going movie to movie.
A little note I have that they did a lot of that because John Hughes had just died.
Oh. R.I.P.
Mm-hmm. That was a sad day. R.I.P. Shermer, Illinois.
What a king.
And because, you know, I'd been meaning to say this, but so now we're talking... Oof. 3 weeks back or whatever. Two weeks back when we did the Tool Time episode. So no, 3 weeks back from right now. Joe said RIP to Al Caprillion. I had looked it up. The weatherman, he is very much alive. So
I believe I said Al. I said RIP. Just for
clarification, he is very much alive. I don't know, alive and well. I don't know. I don't talk to him, but
good evening.
For the people from this area,
sunny.
We're familiar with him. He's still alive.
Well, I'm very happy to hear that. Honestly,
I don't think he's on social media or Cameo or anything. But I don't know. Look him up. Send him a letter. Wish him well.
Can we get Al Caprillion on Cameo? All right. Sidebar that.
Yeah. We'll take a note.
We'll talk after the show.
From him. Yeah, we'll see if we can get in touch with him. So now Duncan tries to bribe Jeff again. So now he calls him up. So Jeff has to leave the group, meets with Duncan in a car.
The voice he does on the phone is so good.
Disguising his voice. And then they meet in the car and they decide, well, he has like the full envelope of what would be all the test answers. And the agreement is... And they get in a tiny car. What did you guys know what kind of car that was?
It's a smart car, right?
Yeah, it had to have been
tiny car,
like a Miata or something. I don't know.
So
it was like Urkel's car.
Yeah, it was like a clown car. So they get in it, and the deal is he will give him the test answers in exchange for Jeff's Lexus, and Jeff will have to ride around in this car as a trade-off. So
I have an issue with that.
I'll let
you finish.
No, I mean that's basically what happened.
It's just he does that, but from what you've seen throughout the episode, Jeff knows how to manipulate him, and I feel like the lawyer and him could have got out of that with the test answers and keeping his car.
I think that's kind of just showing you how desperate he was.
Yeah, that's what I got from it, that he was willing to give up his Lexus.
But he's always
status is a symbol. Status and, you know, having a Lexus or that kind of life is a symbol for him.
As a lawyer, that was probably his moment where, I think Ferg's right in that he could have negotiated a little harder. Like, yes, ultimately he was desperate and had to settle, but he didn't even put up enough of a fight. I feel it was just like, it was more like a come on type deal, and ultimately he succumbs to the offer, and he is now, for a book of test answers, is giving away his Lexus in lieu of having to study for a few months.
I thought that's him actually just giving up, though, understanding what's happening, right? Like, he's sort of letting things go to a degree and being understanding of he's not going to get back to where he was even if he does complete this, because they're always going to look back on him as that guy we figured out. And now, even just the way that sort of that world works, right? Oh, now he has a community college degree. He's not what we thought he was. So I think that he's sort of just like, this is done anyway. Let's just see where it takes us. I think he's just kind of riding out what's going on.
Yeah. Realistically, he'd probably have to he couldn't go back to whatever firm he came from, right? He'd probably have to move off somewhere and start over again, when he has, a clear degree and his bar is all set. And, you know, he could still be a lawyer, but to go back to where where you were, know your reputation. It's probably gonna be a bit tarnished. So, but I think Duncan had a good point when he was haggling with them too, where he was like, yeah, for this is like your test for this one semester, but like, you're not here for one semester. You're gonna want more from me. Like, this isn't the only time you're gonna come to me for a favor. So let's be realistic here. You know, you want 4 years worth of favors or 2 years or whatever it would be. You know, this is what I want. So, I mean, he did have a little leverage with him, but no, I think Ferg's right. He could have fought a little bit more.
Yeah, he seems to just kind of concede, right? Like, he's just like, well, this is where we're at now. But I think that maybe that shows how much he wants to be out of there, that he'd give up his $60,000 car because he just wants to get out of that situation as quick as he can be.
So now there's this moment between Jeff and Britta where he kind of tells her everything going on, and it creates this complete power shift in the situation. And it's like, it was like a weird moment because like now Jeff's like, he was very honest with her about everything, and now he's going to try to make this group work again. And it's more for her. It's more under the promise of like going out, but it like now she has all the power in the situation. Basically, it's still because he just wants to sleep with her, but he's going to at least try now with this group.
Yeah. Yeah.
No, when he goes back in, he has the answers, and he says, he tries to leave with her. She says no. And that's when he says, fine, but anyone who hasn't wasted my time, I have these test answers. And that's when they throw him out.
But that's also when he goes on that huge long tirade too. And he starts kind of, am I remembering this wrong? But this is where he starts going on the Asperger's thing.
No, so that was a little
going on.
That's when he's walking out. Well, so, you have Asperger's.
So the way I, if I remember this correctly, he was going back in and it was more like, hey, we're good now. Like, I got this, we can leave. And she's like, no, what about the group? So yeah. She forced him to go back in because like, she's not okay with him just like, you know, we'll be fine. Now it's like, no, this group's here. Like, you have to help all of them. If you want to go out with me, you need to like get all these guys in a position where like his argument was like, oh, they're too dysfunctional. Like, you know, if they're too dysfunctional, then we can just leave. But that was more like all of a sudden where he was kind of steering the ship, that was her moment of like, no, you're doing this. Like, if I know what you want, and you're only going to get it if you do what I want now, which is go in there and get all of them to where they need to be. So now he's like, okay, we're going to make this work. And he goes in there and he's going to give it like a real effort, again, only because he wants to get with her, but now he's going to actually try. And I thought this was the first time, once he goes back in, it was the first time you really saw him being a lawyer, because everyone's fighting and he delivers this monologue and he's walking and he's doing this thing where it's like his hands are moving up and down as he's walking, is the way he was gesturing, and he was delivering this very like deliberation type speech, and he came off as a lawyer. Like, now you see like this guy is a lawyer. Turned everyone around. And Nick, go ahead.
I just think that whole library scene, especially when you consider a cast of seven, right? I think they did a really good job of rapid fire getting to know each individual character, like better than I think most shows could, because it's a lot of people to have in a cast. And in like that 5 minute period where they're bouncing between the library and back, you have like a really good grasp of each individual character on their own.
I was going to say, I agree. I have that written down in my notes that like, it's a lot of characters, you know, and I know that we've talked about, you know, too little, too many, but this was done in such a way where they gave them all just enough substance that it fleshed everybody out. You kind of knew everybody. You knew where they were. You kind of could see where the dynamics were going to go, where they weren't going to go, but it was just done in a brilliant manner. That, like, so that's interesting.
That's interesting too, because I thought maybe my future knowledge of the show would have skewed me, but the fact that Gordo agrees on that one makes me realize that it was just like a good way to do each character.
It's just a little
you can go. Fur, go ahead.
No, go ahead.
I was going to say, without knowledge of the future show, whatever, but what did we know Joel McHale from at this time, right? He was just doing talk soup. That was it, right? 2 seconds, boom, boom, boom. Sarcastic comment. He delivers some lines here and really takes over the whole show. It's kind of impressive that he's so funny, and you get why he's had the career he's had since then, because you're with him right away. Even though he's scummy, even though he's kind of a dickhead, you just pick up and you're like, oh, well, I'll follow this guy. I get why they're going with him.
It's an interesting character, right? Yeah.
I think, you know, to go back to what you were saying earlier, Nick, you know, all these characters, you do get a good vibe of who they are, and they didn't have to give each character a lot of time, but they gave you enough time to just explain their story. Just even a line or two, just telling you who they were and letting you absorb them. It's like, you know, last week we talked about news radio, and my issue there was they rapid fire introduce you to all these characters and give you nothing about them. And you leave that episode not knowing anything about anybody for the most part, except for one character, essentially, who's going to be there for the next week.
Right.
Here, you have about the same amount of people as you had in that show, but just a little bit of explanation for each character was enough to know who everybody was. And it gave you just an opportunity to be part of that world and know who you were surrounded by. And I think that was huge.
Yeah, but also, I think a good way to, I don't know, differentiate this show as far as character development goes against other shows is that they did it all in one room at one time, right? Like you were talking about with news radio, they bounced back and forth. They went from character A back to Dave, character B back to Dave, character whatever back to Dave. They just let these people go all in the same room together in the same story, that part of the story. And I think that is a big help as far as developing them goes.
Yeah. And they do little things to show their like relationships, like who clicks with who. Like early on, I know like the whole part when Jeff storms out and says, Abed kind of says something to him and he goes, well, you have Asperger's. And Troy and Pierce both giggle about the word Asperger's. Burgers.
Yep. Burgers for your ass. It's
like that. And then the following line is Asperger's. If it was so serious, why don't they call it meningitis? Which is mind-blowingly funny.
So I was going to bring that up because that happens about a minute after what we were just talking about. I was surprised to hear this whole line just because like Asperger's, like, yes, we agree. Like the name of that is, you know, comedic because it sounds like ass burgers, but I thought to go with a joke like that where you are making light of like a mental disability, I was kind of surprised in like a more modern age show that they went with that. It's 11, 12 years ago now when this episode aired, but I feel like even right now that joke would not be in an episode of that show.
That joke,
I think it's just on the cusp, right? They wouldn't let that happen.
I think though it was a inappropriate joke, but the characters that did it, because Pierce is the inappropriate one and Troy is inappropriate too and immature,
and I know Jeff's sense that he delivered it though. Like, I don't know, it's just like we've talked about this before, right? As long as it's like depending on who's delivering it and how it's responded to, but I don't know, I felt like, yeah, this would not fly now because it was like, you know, three of them, like one delivered it, two laughed about it, and no one was really like in defense afterwards.
No, yeah, they were. So. Annie was. She's like, no, that's actually a serious condition.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, she brings it up.
They do talk about it.
Yeah.
So I was a little taken back by that joke, but that was, you know, so to go back, when he did that was basically, Jeff thinks like, okay, I've fixed the group. And then it was like, you know, he turned to Britta and he's like, all right, so now can we go out? And she's like, no. And it was basically like Britta, who, you know, we talked earlier about her character, like her whole thing was like, nothing in this world is more important to me than honesty. Well, Britta lied. Like this whole thing was centered around a lie. She was manipulating Jeff to get, you know, this group in order.
But she'd already been lied to like twice now by him. So
this is more like a mantra, different sort of scenario.
If your mantra is like, I don't lie, then it doesn't justify it. Being lied to, it doesn't make it okay for you to be a liar. So like,
I think in this case it does. Like, cause we talked about what a D-bag Jeff is.
No,
right?
And I agree. Like, I think
so.
Jeff,
I think he had it coming and she knew that.
He has very few redeemable qualities, but I just think for her character, like that was how you were introduced to her. Like one of the first things she says about herself is like, honesty is extremely important to me. I don't know. I just didn't think that made sense. Like,
the second line she said was like, if you lie to me, then, you know, I'll never talk to you again or something like that. So
exactly.
It's already kind of set it up where he lied to her. So now kind of all bets are off. Well, with I think her. That's where I get that vibe.
Yeah, but it's just like, to me, it's like if your whole thing is like, I don't lie, I don't deal with liars, I understand that he lied and now she's like turned off to him. But I was just surprised because like, it doesn't make sense for you to then lie. It just doesn't line up with your character. So, I mean, like it took me a little off, but that basically spun Jeff out of control to just complete heel turn again. So his character's flipped like three times at this point.
So many heel turns.
And it was just like, as soon as, like, as, soon as he's like, oh no, I'm not really like going to go out with you. Then he's like, forget this group. I bet you have Asperger's. And like, he was out of there. And I just was like, okay, so I guess Jeff's bad again. Like, we thought he was going to be a little redeemable for a moment. He had that nice little speech. Although his intentions were still just to get with Britta, like, he still accomplished what he was trying to do. He kind of like got everyone together and did it in a good way.
Yeah.
But the second he didn't get what he wanted, boo-boo faced, and he's like, that's it, I'm out of here. I got all the answers to the test anyways.
But he was willing to share them with the group.
Yeah.
He even says so.
I mean, I see him kind of, Jeff, the main character, is kind of like a chaotic neutral sort of thing. Like, if you were kind of like to align all these people, like, he just seems like a chaotic neutral. You know, he's neither good nor bad. He'll depending on who it is, that whatever he needs to accomplish. That's the way I viewed him.
So, but I feel like he's also looking for a group, and he found them, right? So he's going to be bullish at first, but he immediately is, these are my people, what can I do, right? Because he comes back to them. The fact that he shows them the empty papers, I think the vulnerability of that shows how much he actually cares about these people away, and that he has no other people on his side.
So basically what happened, though, is he stormed out and he went outside, and then that's when he opens up the folder, and that's when he realizes that he doesn't have the answers to these questions. So now he's in a position where he kind of has to try. He just alienated himself from the group, though, and was basically, and now realizes he has nothing. So now he's kind of in a point where if they don't forgive him and let him back in, like, he's kind of screwed because he doesn't have the answers to the test. And now he, at least had he left on good terms, had a group of people that would have at least helped him study. So now he kind of has nothing. And that's when we get to that point where Jeff and Pierce both walk outside because they were, Pierce and Troy walked outside to where Jeff was. And that's when they're like, oh, it was getting a little boring without you in there anyways. And they had like a nice little bonding moment where the three of them all were talking. And slowly as they were talking, the rest of the group all kind of comes outside. So, you know, that's kind of what like led them all back together, was like he kind of had to hit like rock bottom. You know, not that he hasn't had like a series of bad things lead him there to begin with, but
right.
He thought he at least had the answers in his pocket. So when he left there, he left that group very confident. Like, screw all you guys, screw Britta. I'm at least going to pass all these tests and get out of here. You guys figure out Spanish on your own. He goes outside, realizes, uh-oh, I don't have anything. I just lost my car.
Yeah.
For this stack of blank paper. And
I thought that's a scene too where you realize what he's wearing, which I think sums up his character so well, where he's got like a nice sweater, a button up, and a suit coat on, and then track pants. He's halfway in the world of like, I'm this lawyer, I'm whatever, and the other half is like, I'm just fucking done. I can't do this. I don't care anymore. I think that, like, when you see him walk away and you see the stripes in the pants, you're like, okay, that makes sense to where you are right now.
I think they did a good job in that scene of like, he was vulnerable and now everyone sees him being vulnerable and, you know, is showing him some compassion, and it kind of banded everybody together, you know, that got him an invite back into the group, which then causes Jeff's face turn again. So he's the big show of community.
Well,
because I think he had four.
Well, it's your jefe.
He had like four or five face turns. So sorry for those who don't watch wrestling. But yeah, Jeff's character changed so much throughout the episode. And it was one thing that did kind of bother me as I watched it, was like, I just wish, I get it. Like, he's starting off really rough and he has to warm into this group. But I felt like instead of it being like a gradual him warming up and like learning the right way, it was just extremes. He was like a super douchebag. Then all of a sudden he's kind of cool. Then he's a dick again. Then he's kind of cool. And like, I just thought it was like, I don't know. I just think that could have been handled a little bit better.
It just shows you what a chameleon he is, and like, even against his will, like, not as like some sort of special skill, but just his like his personality in general is just kind of gonna, you know, form to whatever it needs to be, and if it doesn't work out, then he reverts back to Dick, you know.
Yeah. So ultimately, though, from that vibe, though, do you get the feeling that like he's only good when he needs to be? Like, is he still like, overall, is he a bad dude?
I think he's definitely presented.
I think the metamorphosis is happening, right?
What?
I feel like you see him changing over.
Yeah, it's just like the changes seem so abrupt each time. And
I see a couple times
where he's nicer and then he flips right back. So you're like, is he really a nice guy? Like, or is he just.
See, I think that was more real. I said last week how it bothered me that on News Radio, the main character suddenly grew a backbone and nothing led to that. Jeff is a dick. And even when like he seems like he's being nice, he has ulterior motives. He fixes the fight that he started. And again, he's just trying to get in Britta's pants. So that redemption wasn't even a real redemption earlier. So I think at that point, it's like, it's unrealistic to think he would change that quick in an afternoon. So I'm okay with it. It's more real than News Radio all of a sudden backbone.
I was going to say they're setting him up to be kind of an anti-hero. You know, he's not your archetype guy that you're going to center a sitcom around. Yeah. You know, you usually you'll have someone who you know, like in news radio, where the main character needs to grow confidence or needs to grow a backbone, but he always has that underlying good to him. Same thing with Home Improvement. Tim Taylor is a chauvinist, but he has that underlying good to him. I feel like with this show, there is no kind of underlying good to him.
Jeff,
this character,
in a lot of ways, to me, kind of is like an older Zach Morris in a way, where he's always got like a trick up his sleeve. He's always trying to find the easy way out. Like, ultimately, he'll learn the lesson, but like it takes him a minute to get there. But, and like, I don't know.
I know,
Zach Morris a bit more than I like Jeff.
But Zach Morris.
Nah, Zach Morris is trash.
But Zach Morris, though, was presented as a good guy. Like, he's presented as someone who is likable versus... him is not likable. You're not supposed to like him from the onset. You're just supposed to kind of be intrigued by him. That's what I saw.
I think part of this show is, especially for a pilot, right? They're not trying to get you to like any one person. They're trying to get you to like the group as a whole.
Yeah. Mm.
Which I think is very successful, right? To be like, look, here are these people. They're all wildly different. They're all funny in their own ways. They're all interesting in their own ways.
And they're all very flawed.
Yeah. And they're all flawed, right? So everyone relates to that.
Yeah.
Do you like this group of people? And I think that's a great move versus being like, do you like this one person and then these side characters? To be like, this show is not about this one person. This one person brought these people together. And by the end of the episode, you know, the show is about everybody, right? The Breakfast Club reference is a perfect reference that Abed makes, where you're like, these are all people I'm going to watch together in a room for one to five seasons. Do I want to stay on board for that? And I think most people will like that.
I was going to say, one could say that are you invested in the community?
Oh,
so I think
I get one. Got him.
So taking some notes, I appreciate that.
When you look at the whole cast, right, like all those characters, even the top guys like Jeff, none of them could have a show about just them, right? Like, maybe Jeff with more development, like because of where he's positioned, but they all have strong personalities and they all work really well blended together. But none of them are a character that that could really hold a show on their own. Like they very much need each other, and that's perfect. That's what you want from an ensemble cast.
That said, though, I would watch Chevy Chase half hour.
Making hot dogs
every week. Anything. Making hot dogs.
I would watch
touching
a Pierce
bread.
Hawthorne show all day.
Yeah, Pierce Hawthorne hour would be my favorite show. So I will say I agree with you. The group, it's the group sort of thinking this one. But aside from that, give me Pierce.
All right, guys. Well, is there anything else you want to say about this show before we move forward?
Just quickly, I forget his name, but I love the dude who plays the Dean.
Dean Pelton?
Yeah, Dean Pelton. Yeah, he's just... I know it's not much in this, but he turns out to be like a really funny character, and he's hilarious.
I get that vibe that he's going to be someone down the line that is going to be funny.
Yeah, it's
kind of since I haven't seen anything, you know, I don't know, but I get that feeling.
I do like that you get the dean's an idiot, the teachers are idiots, the students are idiots. Like everybody's a very level playing field, which is
were
fun.
You exposed to any teachers though? In this,
it's Duncan.
Yeah, John Oliver.
Duncan's
I thought he was
teacher.
Like a department chair. Like
no, he's no. like a he's like
he's
a professor.
Psychology
he's a
teacher.
Of, psychology, like I believe.
Okay,
but yeah, I did think it was a little weird because like the dean, the whole show starts with the dean, right? Like he's the first character you're,
and then you don't see him again. Yeah,
and then he's not back at all. So like
it's almost like Al. Like,
yeah, exactly.
I would have expected maybe one other scene with them at least, but you know, I'll take it. And according to you guys, we see a bit more of them. Like, I have to take your word for it because I'm only going by this episode and legitimately have only really watched this episode. But yeah, it works. I would have thought just a little bit more of him, I guess, but that's fine.
So one thing I didn't remember, and I watched the show, like, this is my office. When I finish it, I start it over. I know that's how you are with The Office and stuff. I don't remember, like, I know the show pokes at community college throughout, like, the entire thing, but I don't remember the pilot being so mean about it. Like, the dean's speech starts it and all that stuff. He loses one of the cards. He's like, I know you think it's a school for losers, but good luck. He's like, oh, I missed another card. And then like Duncan's talking to Jeff and he's like, you ever think about learning something? And then Jeff's line is, if I wanted to learn something, I wouldn't be at community college. And it's just like
Yeah, they do kind of mean to community college, which is not nice.
I mean, like someone who went to community college, it didn't bother me. Like I thought it was hilarious. Like I said, I had a lot of like all that is pretty accurate. Not the mean stuff, but the kind of people that are there. And it's like I have thick skin, but I don't remember it shitting on
community right. And college. Sure, no shades. I didn't go to any college, so I'm not here to say anything. But I was just like, this seems a little mean. I don't know why they're going so hard on people just trying to go to college.
They have to really like bring you into that world and really show you the extremes. And they have to show you that Jeff is in like a last ditch effort to like to succeed, right? Like this is his only chance to become a lawyer again. So I think they have to kind of knock it a little bit just to show you the dire situation he's in.
Right. Is it the community college as a whole, or is it just this particular school that they're shitting on?
I think they're punching down on community college as a whole.
Yeah. He doesn't say I wouldn't be at Greendell. He says I wouldn't be in community college.
Yeah. They're making it clear. Like, listen, and you know, you're not in the Ivy League right now. You're not even in like a state school. Like, this is it. You're in like entry level school, like for as far as college goes. You know, that was the episode. So let's go around. Let's decide whether this is a show that we're going to green light or cancel. And I'm going to go to the left to right that I have in front of me. So Joe, you are first.
Sure. So I'm going to say this as far as this show. I watched a bunch of this when it was new, right? And I hadn't seen it in a very long time. You know how Hulu will pitch you something? They're like, hey, you finished watching this. Do you want to watch XYZ?
Yeah.
For the past year, it's been trying to make us watch Hulu. And in my head,
Hulu's been trying to make you watch Community.
Sorry, make you watch Community. Thank you. And in my head, I was like, I didn't like that show, whatever. When I went to go watch this, it was on episode 14. It had tried to make me watch Community so many times that in the times I'd got up to get food or whatever, they had gone through 14 episodes. I don't know if that's persistence for good or for bad, but we made fun of it all the time. And now I'm like, I'm so glad they tried so hard because I really enjoyed watching the show again without a knowledge of where it goes, which isn't huge, right? I didn't watch it religiously. I just saw it here and there. I would green light it. I think it's funny. And I would be, you'd have to pay me a good amount of money to say something bad about anything Chevy Chase was in. So it's green light for me.
Ferg, you're next.
Definitely a green light. Even if the pilot was terrible, that cast alone is enough to make me come back for next week just to check it out. Great cast, great jokes, pretty edgy. And, you know, that's my sense of humor. Yeah, 100% green light over here.
Nick?
I really wanted to see more of these characters, wanted to see where each of their stories go. I wanted to see where their collective story goes. I just felt like it had a lot more to give. So yeah, green light. I want to keep watching it.
Goro, where do you stand?
I stand at green light. I thought that there was enough intrigue with all the characters, their interactions, the story itself, including the overarching story, made me vested. Makes me want to see how all the dynamics play out. It had just the right dark sense of humor and interactions. And I don't know. It was just like for the size of the cast of the show, I got a great idea of who these people were, where it was going to go. I want to see more. What about you?
So for me, I'll tell you, I literally spent the last couple of days debating. I wasn't 100% on either side. And I was mostly leaning towards the idea of canceling. But as time went on and I kind of thought about it a little bit more, the cast, the ensemble together made me interested enough to want to continue watching it. And I think early my issues with Jeff and how much his character flipped around and how not likable he was up front, something about it just kind of turned me off from the show. But ultimately, they did a good job of bringing you the full experience of like everyone involved, and they gave you enough of everyone, like we talked about, where even in like limited roles, you got to know who everybody was. I think it was so tight. Like if they just did a little bit less with each of them, and they were just more like all thrown at you, like, you know, when we said last week, I think I probably would have canceled it. But because of the whole ensemble, I'm going to go ahead and give it the green light. And I'll say this too. This is a show, like I said, I've never watched a full episode of Community up until this. And there were a lot of times where it's on in the background and I might watch, you know, 5 minutes here and there of various episodes if it's on, you know, whatever time. And for whatever reason, it never really caught my eye. And I don't know why, but I think the important thing in what we do like on this show, starting from the beginning, you know, you start fresh and you are introduced to the show properly. And I think that happens with a lot of shows where you sometimes just being shown a show like in the middle doesn't do it for you. Because like it just, it's not how you were supposed to be introduced to it. So I do think that by watching the pilot, it actually did make me more invested and want to watch the show than any time I had seen a little bit here or there, or like someone sends me a funny clip from the show. This actually was enough for me to sit down, learn what was going on, and want to continue on. So for me, also green light. So 5 green lights. Congratulations to Community. You get to live on. I know you've been kind of struggling throughout the years and up and downs, but you're going to move on to at least an episode 2 from us. So that's all we have for today. Catch us again next week. Let us know what you think. Was this a show that you would have greenlit or canceled? To know what we're going to do next, follow us on our social medias. We'll give you updates on what shows are coming up. You can find all that on the S1E1pod.com. It'll link you to all our social medias, whether it be Facebook, Instagram, all the streaming websites that we're on, YouTube. All of it's at S1E1pod.com. You can find everything there. And we'll catch you next week. Thank you very much. Oh, and also remember, subscribe, rate, keep us going, because those things help us big time. Thanks again, guys. Good night.
Troy and I've been making podcasts.
Why don't they call it meningitis?